Do you want to introduce yourself first?
Yes, I'd like to invite you to do so. Well, I am very, happy to be here and meet you guys and meet new people who actually doesn't know in deep about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So my name is Rajaa Natour. Rajaa means hope in Arabic. I was born in a small city inside Israel to a very traditional Orthodox Muslim community. So imagine, the path I took in terms of being a political feminist activist. For the time being, I live in Jaffa, Jaffa City, and I'm coordinating from impunity to accountability project within the CWP NGO, which is basically focusing on exposing human rights violation of women under occupation from a feminist perspective. I have been active since 2005. It was with ups and downs. It wasn't easy, because as a student in Tel Aviv University, I was afraid of being engaged politically within the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and it took me a while to have the courage and be feminist activist within the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Today, for example, I don't feel that I am privileged to stand away, to not be active, to not be committed to change or struggle. So I'm doing what I'm doing, and in terms of this is actually my ethical obligation to, first of all, to the Palestinian people, and then to women, and then to Israeli feminist activists, to my Israeli Jewish partners who are, part of the path I'm taking in terms of changing the Israel, the reality of oppression, depression, and institutional discrimination and occupation. It was long. That's it.
My name is Lihi Joffe. I was born in Jerusalem to a Jewish Israeli family. I grew up in the center of Israel in Tel Aviv, near Tel Aviv. I'm a feminist activist. I started my way as an active student and found myself in an organization called New Profile, which is against militarization of the Israeli society, where I mostly worked with youth, supporting refuseniks, supporting critical thinking with younger youth, and building a wonderful summer camp every year that would support critical thinking and various subjects that had to do with the occupation, civil rights, gender issues, economical issues. I found myself in CWP when I moved out of school back to Tel Aviv, to Jerusalem, to this center of what is happening. And I found myself in CWP as a feminist activist who had a home to think otherwise, to speak with people, to mobilize, to act, not only to work in an office, but to really be and to create together progress in different thoughts. I'll tell you a bit about CWP, about the Coalition of Women for Peace, that's the initials. The coalition started in 2000 during the Second Intifada by a group of women, feminist women, Jewish and Palestinians, who looked for a place to talk to each other, to work, to stand strongly against the ongoing violence, the occupation, the unequal rights between Palestinians and Israelis. They looked for a place to voice their opinions and to stand strongly together. It soon became an umbrella for different organizations, such as New Profile, to work together to exchange thoughts. All of the organizations were feminist, anti-occupation. They some were Jewish, some were Palestinian, some were binational. And these were the core subjects that they worked on. They were, it still is actually, the CWP is the main, our main goals are to promote anti-occupation discussion, to act to stop the occupation, to actively bring civil rights, equal civil rights to Palestinians and to Israelis, and to work on a just solution for the refugees. Do you want to tell a bit about the project?
Yes. It was fast, amazing. I'm amazed. The CWP actually has maybe four or five projects. One of the important projects actually, and still a continuous project that never ends, is the nonviolent project, which is basically about exposing and exploring creative tools of struggling and with non-violently struggling, and bringing those tools, those creative tools, and the different alternative knowledge of how, for example, women struggle in the U.S., or how women struggle in Sudan or Lebanon, to the Israeli-Palestinian context. The CWP does that through workshops and meetings and reflecting on other conflicts around the world. Basically, it's more about bringing knowledge and tools that have never been experienced and used within the Israeli-Palestinian conflict context. The other thing I would like, you know, just to highlight is things that we've been discussing at CWP, is like only when women use different and alternative tools that haven't been used, actually the patriarchal discourse of how to struggle would actually dynamically change. I mean, it's not only, you know, using new tools, it's more about, you know, the kind of language and discourse and how women actually can change, can make change socially and politically. The second a project is called Armed, which is a very new project within the CWP. Actually was founded at the beginning with the AFC, Friends of American Quakers, if I'm not mistaken. And it moved to shift it and move to the CWP because the AFC decided that they would like to initiate public campaigns and public events, and they thought it wouldn't be wise to do, you know, to speak of the Israeli import and export weapons within, starting within the U.S. Political social context. So Armed is basically about focusing on arm exporting and importing of Israel, linkages between the security budget of Israel and, again, with arming Israel, arming itself, or exporting and importing arms to other places in the world that actually within violent conflict. It's bringing the complexity and linkages between conflicts around the world and inside Israel within the frame of importing and exporting arms. And again, it's done through advocacy, campaigning, screening movies and films and conference on and so forth. There I go. One of the most important projects and initiative that was actually founded in the CWP was Who Profits, which actually started as a small initiative of a small group of women who thought that the political a context in Israel involving occupation is much more complex than, you know, religious, geographic, social, political conflict. They thought that the occupation is sustained by a financial system that, in a way, supported and keeps it going on. So they just started, researching and learning and gathering information and knowledge about international and local companies that are involved within the industry of occupation. And then, I think it was 2014.
Yeah, the project started in 2007. And Dalit Baum was one of the major women who.
Yes, she's a very well-known.
She initiated it. And in 2013, as Rajaa is saying, it branched out on their own NGO.
So today, the whole project is actually an independent research center. And because of the work they do, exposing international and local involvement of lots of companies around the world, is actually lots of people are exposed to the knowledge and information, have access to the knowledge of how their countries are, companies that are well known in the world, such as Volvo and Hyundai and GR6. Are involved actually in human rights violation within the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So it's like briefly about
what's it called?
About
who profits?
Who profits?
Okay. I mean, it's a sister organization.
Sure.
Google them. They have a website, and there are lots of amazing reports done recently that that will give you a lot of cool. And the last. The last project is the one I mentioned at the beginning. The one I'm managing, coordinating, is from from impunity to accountability. That financially supported by the Oxfam Novib Holland, and focusing on human rights violation under occupation in Area C. Bringing within that the feminist perspective and analysis of how women live under occupation, how women's life looks like under occupation. And we'll screen those clips after we, done with this long introduction. I just wanted to mention that the CWP also has not only projects, but also campaigns. So CWP campaigned and still campaigning against the siege on Gaza, the second Lebanon war, and the third one, house demolitions. And the last one, actually, I was amazed to find that there was a campaign of solidarity with Iranian women through the last year. We have also several partnerships with local projects and local initiatives inside Israel, such as the gun on the table of the kitchen. Would you like to
The gun on the table of the kitchen is a project that we're partnering with. And the idea is to talk about domestic violence happening in houses where the men work in security forces, and they are able to take the weapons home from their workplace. So one of the biggest things that happened through this project is that they enforced a law that was frozen that said that they are not allowed to take the weapons home, their weapons to the home. For the past year, the law has been enforced, and in the past 3 months, the law is a bit again ignored because of the escalation that you talked about before of this of Palestine, Israel, and sadly, of course, the government, the very militarized government, said to the people of Israel who can take weapons home, take them home. Have your arms with you all the time, use them to protect yourself. And we see that it has elevated the amount of domestic violence again. So that's a very big project that is happening.
Yeah. The other, it's a partnership, not product.
Product.
It's different because when we mention partnership, mm-hmm. it's like we are involved, but those initiatives actually not our own. So for example, the guy in the kitchen on the table kitchen and the women security index, we're there in terms of contributing to the thinking, to how to research and what to take on, what kind of campaign to do. So they are not our projects. The security, the Women's Security Index, basically focuses on women's security within the Israeli 48 territories, and searching and researching when and how women feel secured. I, for example, had just to mention one of the statistics, like the latest index that was published this year, is that, for example, 70% of Palestinian women inside Israel don't feel that they might anytime be exposed to verbal violence, you know, from Israeli society. And more of 60, it's above 60 that feels that their own house is under threat, and that, you know, in a way they don't feel that they do have a home to go, and, you know, it's secure and it's there. I think that I've mentioned all. I mean, the last one was actually the acknowledgement forum, which is more about the CWP supporting NGOs and small initiatives in the Negev, working in issues like the unrecognized villages in northern Israel, the Bedouin unrecognized villages. Again, those partnerships are more about being involved in the thinking process, reflecting on that, and, you know, and how to take that in terms of analysis and in terms of campaigning and advocacy.
And also in the current situation, CWP has joined with a number of different organizations under a name called Standing Together, for Palestinian and Jewish initiatives, standing together against the violence that is towards the Palestinians inside Israel and the West Bank, and especially in East Jerusalem. Demonstrations, petitions, house forums, like house speaking tour stuff. And also in the past years, there's been anti-democratic laws, anti-civil rights laws that have been passed since 2009. CWP has put to a mission to stand against these laws, including petitioning, going to the high court against one of the laws, specifically the anti-boycott law. We lost, and in 2014, it passed. There were a few other groups that also opposed this law, but in the end, the law passed. So that's part of the things that we're doing, because there is a very, very devastating different laws that are being passed and are hardening our ability to work, and are actually posing CWP in a place that they are anti-Israel, anti-Jew.
Delegitimizing. Operating. I forgot to mention 1325. I mean, you all know what does that mean, but I'm just saying that in one sentence, that the CWP was involved in looking into that resolution of the UN from 2000, thinking and reflecting on it within local Palestinian and Israeli NGOs. And the CWP was engaged in the process of thinking and rethinking, reflecting with that, to support and sign. But to bring the challenges that are really behind the resolution itself, And one of them is for example, the Israeli civil society NGOs speak of violence against women without relating to the reality of occupation. So that one of the hardcore issues that CW people to the reflection thinking process. I will stop there, and in order to deepen our discussion.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أنا اسمي نجية عبد الله حافظ من طمون، عمري 36 سنة. قعدنا زمان عايشين هنا وبنعاني طبعا من مشاكل الاحتلال. سنة يعني يهدموا سنة ما يهدموش، كل ما تمركزنا وحسينا في الأمان لما نحس في الأمان إنهم يردوا، داير سنة يعني يجوا يهدموا يشردونا ويغلبونا. المحل هذا يعني هو مصدر رزقنا الأساس، يعني مصدر معيشتنا، يعني مصدر رزق حلالنا، يعني مصدر يعني بنزرع بنكلع فيه، يعني نتخلينا عنه خلص، يعني في الصعبة ترد تدخليونا. أول العام في 16/9 عام 2013 أجوا هدوا هون عندنا في المجحول، هدونا أول مرة، مسحونا مسح يعني ما خلوش ولا إشي، حتى الناس تيأس يعني وتبعد وما فيش عندها أمل يكون يعني في يعيشوا في المنطقة هاي. ردونا نصبنا يعني ردينا هدونا، حتى هدوا بيجي 4-5 مرات متتاليات ورا بعضهم في المنطقة نفسها. بيجوا علينا الساعة 5 الساعة 6 في جرافاتهم في دباباتهم في جباتهم، يعني في الشرطيات معاهم، الرؤساء معاهم، التنظيم، الكل بيفزع. يعني بتقولي انه تبقى ملحمه، بيمسحونا عن وجه الارض، يعني كل شيء بدمروه، كل شيء بدمروه، يعني ما بخلوا ولا شيء، يعني نهائيا بدمروه. شو الحياه يعني وانت هادمه؟ يعني شو لا بتعرفي تاكلي، لا بتعرفي تشربي، لا بتعرفي تشتغلي، لا بتعرفي تنامي، يعني كل ساعه بتقولي انهم هسه بيجوا بيهدوا، هسه بيجوا بيرجعوا علينا، هسه بيجوا بيشردوا اطفالنا في الليل، حتى في الليل اشطر الخوف في الليل. يعني البنات يعني بتساءلوا يعني هل احنا بنضلنا يعني هيك يعني مهدوية، يعني بنضلنا يعني في خوف في رعب من اليهود؟ كلهم يعني بنطمنهم كلهم لا ما تخافوش، يعني احنا هم بيهدوا واحنا بنبني. يعني مطلبي انا يوقفوا معانا، مطلبي انا يعني دعم جوانيا، دعم معنويا، مش يدعموني في كيس رز، في كيس طحين، في كيس حليب. انا ما بدي اكل ولا بدي اشرب، فاهمي؟ انا ما بدي اكل ولا بدي اشرب، انا بدي اثبت حالي، انا بدي اعيش في طمانينه، انا بدي اعيش يعني في ثبات هون. ما بدي كل ساعه يهددوا اطفالي، بحس الوحده، يعني بحس يعني انه ما فيش يعني انه مقطوعين، ما فيش بشر حوالينا من مره نهائيا، يعني فيش حدا يقف معانا، فيش حدا يساندنا، بدنا ناس تقف معانا، مش يدعمونا يعني من بعيد لبعيد، ولما يجوا يهدوا يعني ما نلقاش حدا.
اسمي سلام شحد النواجعة، عمري 30 سنة، أم لخمس أطفال. عندي الحياة هنا صعبة، أكثر إشي الحياة صعبة، يعني فيش عاد فيش مواصلات، فيش عيادة صحية موجودة في المنطقة. عندنا حالات الوفاة صارت في سوسية من عدم وجود صحة، لأنه السيارات هنا فيش سيارات مأمنة إلا سيارة واحدة وما غير كافية للمنطقة. إذا في سيارة يعني بنقعد ساعة، إذا فيش سيارة ما بنروحش، لأنه الطريق يعني وقت تروحي ماشي صعبة، بدك ساعتين في الطريق. في عنا هنا الكنيسة بتلاقينا مستوطنين بهجموا، بيطلقوا الكلاب على النساء إذا بده حدا يروح ماشي، بيطلقوا الكلاب عليهم. كمان من عند المعسكر من هنا الجيش، يعني الطريق غير آمن نهائي. يعني في أغلب الحوامل بحمل 9 شهور ما بصلنش الدكتور، يا مرة يا مرتين. أغلب النساء المنطقة بحاجة لهذا الإشي، والختيارية الكبار كمان، وحالات السكري كمان، يعني كل الناس المتواجدة هنا بحاجة للصحة. أنا يعني كامرأة حامل مش عارف كيف بدي اصل المستشفى في يطا، لان بلاقي صعوبات. نحن لما اكون في الليل يعني بكون خوف شديد، يعني بكون خوف علي انا كمان، بكون خوف من بكون الجيش في الطريق ما يخلونا نمرق. فيش الامبالانس كمان ما بيخلوا يصل المنطقة الا بتنسيق. طب ما المرأة الحامل يعني ما اكون انا حامل وبدي قالت بدي استنى تنسق مع الفلسطين مع الاسرائيليين مشان يجين الامبالانس. بنشتغل مع الاكشن ايد، اشتغلنا عن بقى الصحة، اثثنا الصحة، جبنا يعني حاجات بسيطة مش يعني كل التأثير. اشتغلنا على المختبر، طلعنا على الدكتور فوزي الرجعي عدورة، قدمنا له كتابين مشان يوفرونا المختبر في منطقة سوسي. وعدنا انه ان شاء الله بصير اشي بس ما نفذوا ولا اشي. انا مطلبي نفسي انه يكون عندنا مخطط هيكلي نبني زي ما المستوطنين بنين. نفسي أولادي يعيشوا بأمان، اللي نعيش في بيت يكون مسكر بمفتاح حامل مفتاحه بإيدينا. هذا نفسي الوحيد يعني إن كنا نعيش بحرية وبأمان يعني زي ما باقي هالعالم عايش.
جازي جبريل نواجع من المواليد سوسي خربي يعني طبعا نفيك. وبالنسبة للأحداث اللي صار معي يعني في أرض من عند اليهود عنها. أنا عندكم من 10 معجات خاتمة واختصر حلاكة ووجهني للمستوطنين. عجل مستوطنين اثنين وحاولوا ياخذوا المعجات مني. المستوطن كان يضربني هيك يعني في ديه ويدعدلني عشان ياخذوا المعجات مني. تعبت منه وصرت أنتفض وطلت الدرجة. ورحنا على قريه 4 شكينا عليهم وجينا بس ما سووا لنا شيء. راحت القضيه بالشكاله وسووا لي بالحاجه. ايش في امان الحين بنخاف امان منهم؟ امي كنا نروح على المحميه وهذا بيجونا بكم شو صار لهم. وقديش بحاولوا يعتدوا علينا يعني بنخاف منهم لان بدنا ننام في الليل واحنا خايفين. بنخاف يجي يحرقونا في الليل يجي يكتب حدا منا. يعني ما بنصدق نار يطلع. احنا في الليل ما بنصدقش نطلع برا الخيمه بنخاف يجي حدا برا ولا مستوطنين ولا شيء. يعني احنا هم عايشين في حالة رعب كل يوم بنعاني من الخوف ومن القلق. النهار يعني بسجل شفت على الخط اللي يبقى ناس معين هاي عندنا اطفال بسجل يطلعوا على ديمونة يطلع معهم على الحمام. شو بدي ساعد ايش حدا يقف معنا يعني شو بدي يوقف معنا بيجي يوم بدي شو بدي سوينا بيجي يوم بصير احداث بيجوا ناس بس بيجوا في النهار وبروح شو بدي مسوينا احنا. بتمنى انهم ما يضلش عندنا لا مستوطن ولا احتلال لازم نكون متريحين ولادنا يكونوا متريحين واحنا نكون نبني لنا يعني بيوت هنا في ارضنا نتمنى نصير زي الناس يعني زي يكون زي بلد. احنا بننتقل ايش عيطة بننتقل عيطة وارضنا هاني كلها يود وين نروح بعدين مهما صار بنضل نعاني بننتقل ايش عيطة لان في شيء مجال احنا اخذوا ارضنا في السيفر واخذوا اراضينا وين مكان يعني ما ضلش الا النت في هذا اللي احنا فيه هذا خذوها منا بنصفي يعني في شيء ارضنا مثلا لا يجين وين نروح انا بدي يقبلنا فيش حدا بيقبلنا يعني يقولنا تعالوا اقعدوا في ارضي باي طريقه يعني احنا نعاني ونضل في ارضنا لو كثرونا لو شو صار مش رايحين نطلع يعني ايش مهما يسوي بيهدوا الخيمه من هنا من الصبار من هناك.
So, when the woman with the kafia was actually taken from the Jordan Valley area, and as you so just watched, I mean, all those women feel all the time that they are afraid and under threat. In terms of being in a struggle, they all feel that they are alone. I mean, they are standing alone without, you know, any local support, not speaking for international, because, for example, Susia has a lot of international support, comparing to the Jordan Valley. International activists actually don't reach, don't go to the Jordan Valley, because the settlers in the Jordan Valley are not that enough violent, and the conflict there is not sexy enough to bring, not sexy enough for, you know, not internationally covered by international media or written about. It's like a bit forgetting. One of the sentences that I was amazed to hear is actually what Najia said. I don't want international or local activists bringing me food. I can feed myself. I don't need rice. I don't need coffee. I can do that very well. The only thing I need is actually to be acknowledged on my land. I just ask for a home, you know, above my head. And it was direct and sincere, and yeah, she knows what she wants. You know, it was basic, and again, speaking of basic a human right for women and for Palestinians to have a home, to know that you can go back and be secure. And a home is actually something that Palestinian women in Susia and the Jordan Valley don't have. If you do have questions, if you'd like to add some anything, it's like I'm gonna open it for discussions or reflection or.
Question. So I was reading in a report released by a women's peace organization, and I forget the name right now, but they were talking about militarization specifically, and the rates of gender inequality in a society and militarization being somewhat related, or at least violence and gender inequality being related. And so I was wondering, when you do work with children surrounding issues of militarization, how do you make that connection between militarization and feminism, or militarization and gender inequality? And using feminism as a way to counteract them.
If I understood the question correctly, first of all, I don't work in that field anymore. But that's exactly what is being done in Israel: the using feminism to put women in more combat places in the army, and. Yeah, just trying to say, okay, this is what feminism is. Let's make a situation where also women can join the army and can be like men without at all breaking down what is to be in the army, what is to be violent, how that is not human, how that is not feminist in any way. And in the current discourse inside the Jewish Israeli community, then it doesn't exist. The critical thinking of women being part of the army at all, there's no critical thinking in that place. There's no place for more radical feminism or for more humanistic thinking inside the army, because the whole army being the occupier, being the people who are demolishing the houses, as we saw, being the people who are stopping the ambulance, stopping the woman from crossing a checkpoint, from walking inside her land to the next place, and also men, of course, allowing settlers to walk into the land that is the Palestinian land, and allowing settlers to work the Palestinians' trees, the Palestinian land. So that's something that is not arguable at all inside the consensus. And working with youth, that's what we do. We try to break these, I used to, but still that's what's happening, trying to break down what really is the army, what really the army is doing, and not just the glorification of being part and being strong and being like combat, G.I. Jane, whatever. So, did I answer?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, thank you.
Do you want to add?
That's only when you have such a successful discourse and such a successful system, you could sustain occupation. I mean, creating more and more women and men who can stand on those checkpoints and don't see Palestinians. I mean, and think that those things that they do in checkpoints and other places in the West Bank and Gaza are eligible because as Jewish actually are defending ourselves from the Palestinian, and the way to do it actually is to do that through checking Palestinians, through attacking Gaza, through discrimination, and through a blockage and siege on Gaza. Those, you know, the Israeli administration, the Netanyahu government, speaks only power, and speaks only discrimination, and speaks only occupation, and speaks only violence. And this is the way to speak to Palestinians. And so I do relate. This is my take on you know, the implication of having a militarized society. It's not only, you know, to be a soldier or to be a muscular and strong and, you know, stand and a checkpoint. It's like you don't see Palestinians by face. They don't have faces. Mm-hmm. They don't have stories. They are nobody. For example, today in the checkpoints in Israel, in most places have gone a process of privatization, so nobody has actually any access to monitor them. Nobody knows what those young soldiers do on those checkpoints. It's hilarious. In terms of human rights violations, they can do anything without. You know, anybody actually monitoring, reporting, writing, reflecting on that. Again, human rights, impunity, and accountability. There is no such discourse in Israel. It's totally silenced, totally unspoken. I and Lihi were thinking of, you know, what we would like to ask you as people who are, you know, involved in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in different angles, is to speak about it. Those women, to speak about those women, to speak about the human rights violation of those women and Palestinian in general, to write about those things and to be interviewed in mainstream media, and more speak about it, more and more tell other people about it, more and more write about it, more and more. I don't know, tweet, Facebook about it. This is actually the way you bring those women's voices to the glass and breaking the silence discourse about, you know, a human rights violation. And yes, I do, and I would expect that you would want to hold Israel accountable for its deeds. Hopefully.
Would you say that there's a kind of movement towards that, or do you think that the international community as a whole is still very much afraid of being labeled an anti-Semite and afraid to speak out?
I think because there is a move towards that, but I mean, locally, I don't feel that this way. Public opinion is thinking that way. Is actually, you know, thinking that occupation is false. Controlling other people and oppressing other nations is something that they would think that is really false. It's the way we protect ourselves. This is the Netanyahu discourse. So I don't feel that in terms of, you know, the local political arena, something is really moving. But I mean, I would say the opposite about the international political arenas, because of the BDS movement, lots of people, young students and communities, NGOs actually are well known about, you know, the engagement of local and international companies, firms, and sustaining occupation. So there is the financial discourse for profiting and how, but again, this is actually the say of Palestinians themselves about the occupation itself, and the basic demand of the BDS is actually holding Israel accountable to its deeds, and you know, complying, obeying the international law. I think that there's nothing wrong with the international law. It's something wrong with the international community that is, you know, it's not holding Israel accountable to its deed. But I would assume that there is lots of small activist group in the whole world that, you know, speaking of the Israeli-Palestinian issue in campuses and in different other platforms. I follow lots of them on Twitter. So I do think that internationally something is really shifting. But locally, I would assume it's, I don't know what Lihi thinks, but it's...
But not the U.S.
Maybe.
The Presbyterian Church is a good example of...
Of
making, actually passing the...
Getting
out of... Divesting into Israel, which is
absolutely
really good.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's just, you know, it's just kind of difficult when all the prominent governmental positions are occupied by very fanatical, you know, Zionists and, you know, Israelis who, you know, I mean, or even the, you know, the evangelical Christians who are, you know, who are throwing hundreds of millions of dollars, you know, for Israel for good reasons, but then Israel turns around and they're using it for their own kind of act of, you know, terror and apartheid. I mean, we have to call it the way that it is. You know,
yeah.
Israel has a right to exist, absolutely, but so does Palestinians. Where are they supposed
well.
To go? So let me ask, I just want to ask you one question. Do you think that the Iranian nuclear deal is kind of key to kind of forcing, you know, peace in the Holy Land?
And what means?
And, you know, maybe if not establishing a Palestinian state, then to kind of make, you know, living solutions for the Palestinians much better.
I still don't understand the question.
So I'm asking you that, do you think that the move by Congress to make a deal with it, because while I was living there and for my own study and my own research, I felt like that Israel, the Netanyahu regime, kind of used the Iranian nuclear deal, well, to put the attention on Iran to create a diversion to to make peace with the Palestinians. So I feel that that's why he really pushed against a nuclear deal. So I feel that because once that Iran had a nuclear deal in place, then the international focus would shift onto the Israel and kind of force them a little bit more to, you know, create a peace deal.
Because
these are the issues that I study and the issues that I focus on, so.
It is something that a lot of times has been sent, even in the mainstream media, that the Iranian, Netanyahu will bring up the Iranian problem or threat in order to hide what is actually happening, which is the occupation, the two different law existing, discrimination of the Palestinians. So that is said, and time will tell. Also, to get back of before, what you were asking, the question of, what was the first question?
If there is a shift in terms
right.
of accountability. And
Yeah.
I think that the laws that are being passed are making people afraid to say their thoughts, and also, which is much more bad, is making people much more right-winged.
Right.
It's making people demonize Palestinians, and there's a lot of creating hate inside school systems and workplaces, monitoring Facebook, all these kind of things that is creating much more hate and hatred from Jews towards Palestinians. So So what organizations like CWP or similar organizations are trying to strengthen the critical thinking, strengthen the feminist anti-occupation.
That was very prevalent even here in the U.S., especially with in regards to the refugees. I mean, here in America, you know, with, you know, the San Bernardino tragedy and the Paris tragedy, you know, everyone here in the United States, they hear refugees and they hear terrorists.
Wow.
Every refugee is a terrorist, which
yeah.
is completely ludicrous.
Yeah.
Because, you know, ISIL, as President Obama said the other night, they're thugs and they're criminals. They don't represent what Islam is.
Mm-hmm.
And then everyone here thinks that every refugee from Syria is Muslim. No, they're all Christians. They're all displaced people who have been academics. They have been high level, you know, professionals and everything that are, unfortunately, they are, you know, casualties of this, you know, political instability that are forced to leave. But since, you know, all this propaganda starts happening, we've cultivated, you know, a culture of fear here,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is tragic. So, like you were saying, like how we use our schools and we use our, you know, our voices, you know, sometimes to breed fear, you know. Because, you know, a lot of people, you know, it's not only just being branded anti-Semitic, it's also, it could also, you know, have you lose your career,
mm-hmm.
or worse,
right.
for speaking out for what is right.
Yeah. I'm sure American Muslims now are feeling also much more, probably much more hatred and are being
Absolutely.
Looked on.
Right.
But I would challenge that because I think the public opinion polls are the majority of Americans welcome refugees. But it's the political leadership and the media that is
mm.
feeding this cycle of fear. And so
oh,
I think one of the things we can do
mm.
is not buy into the propaganda and say our leaders are out of touch with where the American people are in terms of welcoming refugees. Because it's politically, fear works for political leaders, I would say. And that's where I think I am. A key part of kind of understanding this is following the money trail. So like
mm.
When you mentioned the kind of part of the coalition that's now focusing on the arms trade and the sales of Israel both being receiving lots of weapons and being a large exporter of weapons, I think that that's actually more of a link of a lot of governments because it's, you know, the trade is, it's convenient to say, well, we don't want to appear anti-Semitic. But in fact, they like some of the deals in terms of the IT surveillance. And if you think of, for me, the number of people in the military in Israel that put in a career and then are trained in the IT sector and surveillance sector and then do startup industries, those industries will only keep working if there's a climate of fear.
Yeah.
Because you don't need strong surveillance. You don't need all these cameras everywhere if people are getting along. So only if you sustain and institutionalize fear, that's a market strategy,
mm-hmm.
not just an idiot, you know, not just a, so fear of terrorism or whatever is helping drive the market forces of certain industries that really benefit from this whole thing. So I always kind of look for the money trail of
right.
what's
going
on.
I mean, David, adding to that also the ethical side of, you know, arm trade. I mean, Israel was involved in exporting arms to Venezuela and to Sudan and to other places that had a bloody violent conflict without even, you know, posing the question of why and how, what does, you know, those arms actually creating to the paramilitary groups.
Every
creating
conflict
more
on the continent
and
more of Africa
killing.
Has Israeli arms dealers.
Yeah.
They actually dealt with Hamas and also with Iran. So,
so
I mean, the Iran-Contra deal from the 1980s was facilitated through Israeli channels.
If I'm not mistaken, aren't the Chinese also involved?
Yeah.
In Iran?
Yes.
Oh, there's quite a few. Yeah, everybody is one when it comes to arms trade. You
oh,
know?
Yeah, of course.
It's amazing you're mentioning the Chinese and the Japanese markets because now with the EU, branding the products of the settlements in the West Bank and Gaza, so Israel started seeking alternative markets to its own goods and arms, which are the Chinese and the Japanese markets, because the EU is closing it, not allowing any exporting from the. Supplements products. Cool. Yeah, sorry, still.
I wanted to ask you about your communication tools, what you use to communicate with Israeli society, but women living in the occupation, like what are your tools or what is your strategy? And then do you feel it's working or do you feel there's no response to it? And then also a second question, but you said about the checkpoints, that they're being privatized. If you can just say a little bit about how this is working, like if it's private security companies, and then those two questions. Thank you.
So CWP also has a website, a Facebook, Twitter, the e-media, and also does like meetings, open meetings. And we just had, just last week, just before we came, we had a big event that Rajaa was screening the three films, short films, and a discussion, a panel with three women on these subjects.
Is it available in
we're gonna
Hebrew
send it to you if you
as well as English and
yes, it's actually available in Hebrew and Arabic and English.
Okay,
like the subtitles are on all three languages. So and the event was very big and very.
Where was it?
In Jaffa.
Okay.
Yeah.
But we also, as I said previously, we advocate. We do those public events. Lots of marketing materials, campaigning, a huge demonstration arranged with different political partners. This speaking tool is one of our tools, you know, to speak and meet other people who know or well informed, and you know, bring the Palestinian conflict in front and speak of human rights violation and occupation and women human rights defenders and so on and so on. So we use a lot of a wide range of tools, you know, to reach out. So I don't know which of those, you know, are the most successful. I mean, we use all. I would assume that, for example, the demonstration has a huge demonstration has a different effect than, for example, this meeting, or advocating, or meeting Congress members. It's different. Congress members is more about trying to bring institutional change, political institutional change. Being in the space with a huge demonstration is like of, you know, occupying the space and, you know, with a huge and clear message of anti-occupation or, you know, struggling against occupation or struggling against the human rights violation. It's, I mean, each tool has different goals and different means and different, and we use them all.
When you, sorry, just following up on what you said, when you have these public events, not necessarily demonstration, but public events, when you have panelist members, is there some questions from, you know, the public or the audience that comes back to you often? Is there like some main questions, or is it just, you know, people wanting to learn about the conflict or learn about the occupation? Or is it something that is, you know, comes back a lot as a
I feel that one of the things that I meet is basically, for example, those three clips are, you know, bringing the harsh and complicated reality without a real immediate solution. So lots of women, activist women, would say, okay, so you traveled and filmed and we have screened those testimonies, and what kind of, you know, solution is there? I mean, it's like lots of them, you know, pose the question of depression and feeling that nothing is really, you know, changing. In terms of, you know, grassroots level. A lot of those women, I mean, the feeling of being alone in a struggle is not only what Najee and Islam and Jazia feels. It's the feeling of lots of activist women mm-hmm. around, you know, the political doing of, you know, struggling against mm-hmm. occupation. So mm-hmm. lots of women feels, you know, they are alone and they are few, for example.
Mm-hmm.
They're standing alone.
Mm-hmm.
There is no, you know, international community that actually in massively supporting them and mm-hmm. in bringing their voices. Those basically the issues I made.
Mm-hmm.
The deep feeling of depression, you're depressed as an activist.
Another way of one of the things that we do is educating each other
mm-hmm.
on specific fields that have to do with the ongoing occupation.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's a course that was on who profits, about who's profiting, about the economical profiting of the occupation, and then when we activists know much more and go deeply into the subject, then we can go back to our own communities and knowingly, with facts, tell what's really happening.
Mm-hmm.
Going through a course, CWP had a course of filming, of what to do in demonstrations,
mm-hmm.
like giving feminist activists also tools
mm-hmm.
On what to do
mm-hmm.
when we're on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
So that's
I mean, we had lots of activists also, feminist women activists, speak of, you know, again, I spoke of depression, but the well-being of, you know, women human rights defenders. I mean, in order to still be able to struggle as a woman, as Palestinian or Israeli, it doesn't matter, but as a feminist activist, whether you are Palestinian or Jew or international, you need to have a platform through which you can process
mm-hmm.
difficulties and oppression and depression, because you face those in demonstration, you face those when you visit those women in
mm-hmm.
the Jordan Valley, or the women of Susia, or demonstrate against the siege on Gaza, because we do face police violence as
mm-hmm.
as women.
Mm-hmm.
So the well-being of activists is something, an issue, clearly an issue that I keep here all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Hope we answered
your
question.
Okay. We'd like to also maybe ask you where you think in your own organizations what you can do, what you can relate to, if this touches your field. I'll open a 2-minute watch to see.
maybe I'll start a thing. So I come from the Division for Palestinian Rights,
right.
And we service a committee. It's the Committee on the Exercise of the Inalienable Rights of the Palestinian People. So that's also why I was asking about the audience and how you reach, you know, the public opinion. Because our division, we organize international meetings, so throughout the year and then around the world. And this year we had a meeting in Vienna about the situation in Gaza. We also had a meeting in Moscow about the political and two-state solution, and then more recently in Brussels about Israeli settlements. And next week there will be also an international meeting about Jerusalem in Jakarta. So that's the mandate of the committees, to raise awareness about the question of Palestine. And sometimes it's difficult for us to see, you know, where is this information going, because we have
mm-hmm.
panelists. And we invite all the member states, so they come, you know, the diplomats in the capital, in Moscow, Brussels, they come and attend. But it's, you know, when your activity is raising awareness, it's also sometimes difficult to see who is getting the information. Are we providing, you know, enough information for, you know, NGOs to take action, or for, you know, governments to be aware? So it's also interesting, you know, to see from a civil society organization how you what are your communication tools, you know, to raise
awareness? I think that the personal story, such we, you know, the clips
yeah.
we've seen are the most powerful,
mm.
the most, you know, they communicate directly, they bring the
mm.
face of the people who,
yeah.
you know, who are
Magic
so, so much distance and far from you. It's honest, it's direct, and it's face to face, and
mm-hmm.
simple in terms of bringing, communicating the information. Because when we at the CWP started thinking of what kind of materials you, and you know, tools we want to use in order to break down the impunity discourse, it was like, you know, how could we speak the occupation not in simplistic way, but in communicatable way,
mm-hmm.
Through which you, as a woman who works here in New York City, could, you know, watch this
mm-hmm.
movie and, you know, relate to that, be touched by that, and, you know, decide that this is one of the issues that you want to reflect, think, advocate,
mm-hmm.
Act upon. So, I mean, because I think this is the most powerful,
mm-hmm.
you know, and meeting people, you know, person, this person, you know, having them, you know, them and the personal platform speaking to you as American audience.
Mm.
Cool, how about, we are good with
yeah,
time? Or, cool.
Do you, does your organization try and enter the Israeli society or the Palestinian society? Do you do stuff, public events?
Yeah, so we have these international meetings. It's more international conferences, and the main audience is the member states. It's raised awareness of member states, but also international organizations and civil society. So we invite civil society as both speakers, you know, as panelists, and also as attendees. So we have both Israeli and Palestinian speakers, and we have a number of NGOs that are accredited to the committee, both Israeli and Palestinian, but it's more difficult, obviously, to reach out to you know, Israeli civil
mm-hmm.
society, and so it's more difficult. So that's why also I was asking
mm-hmm.
to see, like how to reach.
Yeah,
I mean
you're posing a
opinion.
very important question, because when we, it's always the question of, you know, when you produce marketing material
mm-hmm.
or advocacy policy. It's the question of who are your audience,
exactly.
and how to communicate with them is crucial.
Mm.
We think that all the time.
Mm.
It's on our back heads all the
mm-hmm.
time. How we do that? Who are, you know, our audience? With who we spoke previously, and with who when, you know, now we want to speak. Is it the general public opinion, or is it, for example, students in Tel Aviv University?
Mm-hmm.
Is it Palestinians within the West Bank and Gaza, or is it Palestinian within 48 territories? Is it women,
mm-hmm.
and how to speak with women, how to relate, how
mm-hmm.
to bring it closer, how to make it, you know, to make occupation again something that women, children, students, and activists can understand. I mean, it's not, you know, again, not checkpoints and the one state or two state solution. It's this woman not having access to medical services. This is occupation.
Mm-hmm.
Is the children, Najia's children, not having access to education.
Mm-hmm.
That is occupation. It's that woman who Jazia said, not having access to her land. It's that those are the messages,
mm-hmm.
and those are the most powerful. It's simple, direct, honest, but it's not simplest. It's not simplifying. It's
mm-hmm.
simple in terms of, you know, it's clear.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But this is, you know, those are
mm-hmm.
really huge question, and
mm-hmm.
I do, I mean, I so much have sympathy to you when you
mm-hmm.
have those, you know,
yeah.
questions in your mind. It's harsh.
Yeah.
It's harsh, and we always think of how we could widen, you know, the range of audience and people who could get, you know, can get and relate to our messages, political messages.
Mm-hmm.
How can, you know, we gain more feminist women, Palestinian and Jewish activists to the CWP? It's an ongoing task.
Mm-hmm.
It's an ongoing process of thinking how and where and to who.
Mm-hmm.
and adjusting that. And in Israel, it's much more harder than the U.S. because the Israeli conflict is like changing and shifting each minute,
mm-hmm.
and it's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy to be very, you know, sophisticated,
mm-hmm.
and well, you know, to think it through
mm-hmm.
very well, so you can, you know, communicate
mm-hmm.
your political message in terms
mm-hmm.
of, you know, it could be heard.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can say a few. We're United Methodists are have our general conference coming up in May, so that's every 4 years. So we will discuss and debate investment again, and I think actually it's very likely we'll divest from some companies before then, so in the next couple months. We already divested from one company, G4S, because of the links with the Israeli prisons.
Mm.
As well as just private prison security industry as well. But I've also worked with a number of ecumenical groups, the World Council of Churches, and with Kairos Palestine, then Palestinian Christians,
mm.
on trying to get churches to discuss more the full range of boycott, divestment, and sanctions as tools. So the churches have tended to just talk about divestment and then kind of gently stepped into boycott, and universities have tended to be mostly on the boycott end of things because they've already divested, they don't own any stock, so it's like, except for challenging the trustees of the company. And so I think that, like, to understand the historical use of boycotts as an anti-colonial struggle, so when, like in India, Gandhi and others use boycott as a tool, as a nonviolent tool. And so to me, it's just like, I think it's incredibly effective. And one of the measures is that there's a number of US states that are adopting laws prohibiting and punishing people that engage with the boycott as a nonviolent action, but are blocking any effort to have further gun control for access to guns for people who want to do something like the attack in California last week. And that means that guns are not a threat. The real threat is nonviolent action that shows that people can get along, that breaks that cycle of fear. And the other thing that we've tried to do really is to frame what's happening in Israel-Palestine from a human rights approach,
mm-hmm.
so that it's not a conflict of two sides. And then there's good guys and bad guys. And
mm-hmm.
we know how that kind of falls out usually. And so I think that, like, Iran is one of the ways that the Israeli government and some of the US government and the whole deal there, or being opposed to the deal, reframes things still as this conflict of two sides. And so then the bad guys are Iran, and Palestine must be aligned with Iran. And so you've got the list of bad guys. And if you approach it from a human rights standpoint, it breaks through that of saying, well, like, and that's why I like the video, it was very good of just, so what's happening in people's lives? And this is, all this political nonsense is being played out tragically over and over again. And that's where I think also it's a good sign in some ways, although I'm not saying it's easy, that Israeli, the Knesset is also pushing these anti-boycott things,
mm-hmm.
shows how threatened they are, which also means they're vulnerable a little bit. Although it may not appear that way right now.
And something is succeeding in a way.
Yeah. And so I think my own sense is that people are quite willing to accept that they're getting a lot of propaganda in the media, but feel powerless of what is it I can do. So that's why like the speaking tour here is an opportunity for people not to just say, okay, are things on the ground awful? Yes. Are we getting the full story? No. But what can we do? And so then, you know, connecting with the coalition is a way of saying, oh, well, this is an entry point. This is where we can build, like, grassroots connections of what's happening here. So that's why I'm very excited that you're here and able to be, you know, visiting and meeting with a lot of different groups.
The Greek Orthodox Archdiocese has our major clergy lady congress once every 2 years. It's coming up this last year we had a Middle Eastern Christians panel. my department. So this year, next year, we're at the beginning of July, we're having our major clergy-lady conference down in Tennessee, Memphis, I think. So anyways, it's about 1,000 parishes in the entire archdiocese. Yep. So all of the priests come, there are two delegates from each parish, and basically they're just meeting about anything and everything. And so basically my department deals with global affairs, ecumenical type interfaith, and we're afforded 4 events, and I have to present 2, so I would love to tie in something with Israel-Palestine, you guys, and kind of like the greater Near East kind of situation. So we'll definitely have to exchange cards, definitely, and hopefully, you know, we can work something out where you guys, where you two ladies come down and speak. It'd be wonderful, I think. Everyone would love that.
Thank you all for your amazing audience. Thank you, George, for filming this session.
So where else are you going? I know you're going to DC.
We actually in 2 hours have another event.
Yeah, we're going down to UPenn.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, for just like a few hours and coming back. But we're going up to Albany on Wednesday. We're going to be in Barnard University tomorrow. We're going down to Pennsylvania again, and to Delaware, the University of Delaware, and down to D.C. And then we're coming back to New York.
How long is this tour?
Until the 18th.
What, is it just getting started?
We just started.
Wow.
This week. Yeah. There's a big event on the 17th that JVPR are organizing that I can send to you the
That'd
invitation.
That'd be good, then I can send it out. Here in the city, or
it's going to be in the city. In school research, something new school.
New school for social research.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's funny. Yeah. And JVP is organizing it, so
very good.
That helps the anti-Semitism.
The
what did you say, David?
That's on the 17th.
That's on the 17th, on the evening of the 17th. Yeah.
But quite a lot of those.
Right. So we'll hand out a few.
I just passed them.
Oh, cool, amazing.
Great, and we can be in touch.
Absolutely.
Yeah, lovely.
Okay.
Wonderful.
Do you know Dalit Baum?
I'm sorry?
Do you know Dalit Baum?
No.
Okay.
I do not.
The Dalit was out in the Bay Area, in San
Francisco.
Right,
yeah, she's not in the East.
She's terrific, and with the
amazing.
American Friends Service Committee has developed a really great tool for analyzing portfolios and stockholders, and it's just afsc.org/investigate.
Okay.
And if you go to that, you can then actually upload an Excel sheet or a PDF that lists companies that, so, you know, if you wanted to see, you know, with the, in the Orthodox Church, like the holdings, if you have it in a form, they will analyze which ones are involved with the occupation and which ones are, you know, what, how they're involved, and just say you've got 20 companies or out of 200 that are involved, and then you can figure out what you want to do with that.